Good afternoon. The title of this title of my talk is Experimental Demonstration of the Coexistence of a Continuous Variable QKD's System with an Intense DWDM Classical Channel. And this is a joint work with the people in Telecom Paritech and also in SecureNet. Okay, QKD is a well understood part of quantum information, but it's not yet widely adopted. So what does QKD need to become a successful industrial technology to avoid this situation? Okay, the main challenges for QKD development are the performance, of course, the key rate and the distance. So we are having high key rate and longer distance. And in terms of the practical security, we have side channels attacks and the countermeasure to kill the kill such loopholes. And most importantly, we need to integrate QKD into existing classical network infrastructure. Consider a QKD link, a QKD system that cost you $75, for example, that uses a dark fiber, which is leased for around $2,000 per kilometer per year. So you can see here, the running cost of the entire system, in the running cost of entire system, the fiber can be the highest operational the fiber gives the higher operation cost for a QKD network for years. So the solution is to share the fiber using a technique called the wavelength division multiplexing. There, multiplexing several optical channels in the same fiber. So there are two standards. One is called dense wavelength division multiplexing. You can use many optical channels densely packed in a single optical fiber using a module called a DWDM. So the spacing in the channel can be varies from 0.2 nanometer to 0.8 nanometer. So you can have more around 300 channels in a single fiber. Or in the coarse WDM, you can have only few channels because the spacing in a single channel is 20 nanometer. Okay, so what about the QKD in a WDM network? So a WDM network, this is a simple WDM network where you send the send a classical channel and the quantum channel through a single optical fiber. Here, the classical channel is first amplified using erbium doped fiber amplifier, then multiplexed to the optical fiber using this DWDM module. And also Ali sends her quantum signal through the same channel. So at the Bob side, when Bob demultiplexed the quantum signal from the optic fiber using another DWDM module, so here it is called a DMAX. So the quantum signal, Bob gets the quantum signal plus the noise generated by the classical signal in the channel. So what are the noise sources in this configuration? The first one is the leakage of the classical channel to the quantum channel due to the finite isolation of WDM modules. The second one comes from the amplifier due to amplified spontaneous emission, or it can also be considered as a background emission from a classical laser. For example, if you are not using amplifier, but your classical laser can generate a multiple modes, so this mode can pass through the classical channel, and that can reach to Bob, so that can add a noise photon. And the third one is the Raman noise photon. It's actually generated by interaction of photons with the optical phonons inside the classical inside the fiber, and due to the non-linearity of the optical fiber. Apart from these three main terms, there are four-way mixing, but it's quite low at higher distance, so you can neglect it, and also you can have Rayleigh scattering, which is the scattering at the same wavelength of the classical channel, so you can isolate it by using a good isolator. Okay, consider the simplest network with a classical channel power of 0 dBm, which is 1 milliwatt, and using a DWDM module with a spacing of 100 gigahertz, which is 0.8 nanometer spacing, having isolation of 80 dB, and having an insertion loss of 0.5 dB. Here shows the different contribution of noise sources on a single photon detector. Normally, single photon detectors are used in discrete variable quantum key distribution. So if a single photon detector with 1 nanosecond detection window, it collects all these noise photons. So here you can see that in this graph, the amplified spontaneous emission, the contribution from amplified spontaneous emission is quite low, so you can neglect it. And the leakage is the blue line. It's decreasing with the increasing distances because the leakage photon from the Alice to reach Bob through the fiber, so it decreases. And the green line is the Raman photons. So the major contribution comes from the Raman scattering. Here you can see the mean on average at higher distance with 1 milliwatt of classical channel power. Per nanosecond, you have 0.3 photons. Normally, the discrete variable QKD that employs weak coherent laser pulses, which that uses mean photon number from 0.1 to 0.4. So the question is whether QKD is possible with such classical power. Yes, it's possible. There is previous work on QKDs. So this table shows some of the results, and they were using some special techniques to reduce this excess noise comes from the classical channel, and they have some drawbacks. For example, using narrow band filter to filter the excess noise photons, so that increases the insertion loss, definitely, and using special temporal filtering techniques that use smallest detection windows, so you have to use low jittering detector, which are the superconducting single photon detectors, and separate the classical channel away from the quantum channel, so the noise generated by the classical channel do not reach to the quantum channel, so that is actually not compatible with the DWDM network technology. And the most interesting thing here is use low power on the classical channel, so it won't generate much more noise photons on the quantum channel. This picture is a DWDM transceiver normally used in a classical network. It's from Cisco. So it generates a power of 4 dBm. So with such power, can we do real QKD distribution, quantum key distribution in a modern DWDM network? That's a open question. Okay. In continuous variable, QKD is a promising candidate in such situation. The preliminary work has been done by Bing-Chi et al. And they have shown that the homodyne detection acts like a filter. In homodyne detection, you have a local oscillator, you have a signal. The local oscillator and signal interfere on the beam splitter, so you can subtract the current from the photodiode, and you can extract the information about the signal from the variance of the photocurrent, the subtracted photocurrent from here. So the local oscillator, the Photons which are incoherent with the local oscillator is only effectively amplified by this homodyne technique. For example, if you use a local oscillator with 10 to the power of 8 photons per pulse, you can get 10 dB of isolation without using any extra filter. That is a promising feature of the CVQKD system that employs homodyne detection, which, because it has an intrinsic filtering property. To remove noise photons which are not incoherent with the local oscillator. So, the main noise sources of the CVQKD, main noise source in CVQKD is Raman noise, Raman scattering. But actually, you can actually divide this noise photon into two. One is called outband photons, which are the photons whose wavelength are different from the classical, different from the quantum wavelength. So it mainly comes from the leakage. So they are called unmatched. And other set of noise, which are called band in-band photons, which are in the same wavelength as that of the local oscillator, but out of those photons, you need a coherence with the local oscillator to generate any noise on your homodyne detection. So they are called matched photons. So Raman noise is the main source of noise for a distance greater than a few kilometers. Normally the QKD works not for a few kilometers, but kilometers from 10 to a few tens of kilometers. So the main source of noise is Raman. Here shows the Raman noise spectrum, which is having more or less 200 nanoseconds of width. And you can have these Stokes lines and the Stokes photons and anti-Stokes photons. The noise at the anti-Stokes region is quite smaller than the Stokes region, so you can select your quantum wavelength at this region because the noise is quite smaller. So there are two configurations. One is called the forward configuration, where you send the classical channel from Alice to Bob. So the power at the input of this DWDM is equal to the input launch power, and the scattering beta Raman is a scattering cross section of the Raman cross section of the fiber. L is the distance, alpha is the attenuation of the fiber, and the delta lambda is the spacing of the DWDM. Similarly, you can have the backward scattering configuration where you send the classical channel from Bob to Alice. That also having this the same, the relation is given in this equation also. Okay, the typical the backward and forward scattering with the distance is given in this figure. So you can see the red line is the backward scattering. So the backward scattering increases 30 to 21 kilometers, then decreases. Sorry, the forward scattering. And the backward scattering is the blue line, and it's saturated after 21 kilometers. So we calibrate the Raman noise, Raman scattering noise on a balanced homodyne detection by sending few classical channel that multiplex to a single fiber using a DWDM. Then in a forward configuration and also in the backward configuration. And we use add and drop module. They are special elements, so you can detach a particular wavelength from a main data traffic line. So we use an add and drop module that takes the photons of photons which are having the wavelength at same as that of the local oscillator. So we could study the impacts of this noise photons on the homodyne detection. So we have to make two sets of measurements. One is the short noise measurement, which is the inherent, when you send the local oscillator alone to the homodyne without any signal, you get some noise, and it's called short noise. And when you send some signal, the local oscillator picks it and then amplifies, you get total noise. So you need two sets of measurements. But if you make two separate sets of measurement, you have this problem of fluctuation homodyne. So your temperature changes, or the data acquisition points changes with the time. So normally you get this kind of behavior here. So you have the, you measure the signal, and then later you measure the short noise. So they have different fluctuations. So you, this gives instability in your measurement. So we have added a amplitude modulator in our setup. So this amplitude modulator, we switch off the amplitude modulator for one pulse. Then we take the, so there won't be any transmission. There won't be any transmission, so we can make the short noise. We can calculate, acquire this short noise. Then we switch on the amplitude modulator, which is so the signal can go through the harmonic detection, so we can make total noise measurement. So this improves the system stability. So they both short noise measurement and total noise measurement experience same kind of fluctuation. So you can detect the correct value of the Raman excess noise by this method. So it gives us some stability in our measurement. So this is the result. So this is the forward scattering result. So the lines are the fitting curves. And this is the backward. So we have started from 1 milliwatt channel power to 10 milliwatt. 10 milliwatt we achieved using 5 different channels, each channel having 2 milliwatt power. And we fitted this data, and they are fitting with the experimental value by using the following parameters. So on a homodyne detection, so at the excess noise at Alice that we have seen is maximum around 25 kilometers, and it's very low. For example, for 1 milliwatt, we are seeing 0.1% of short noise, and for 10 milliwatt, we are seeing 1% of short noise. So this is our the experimental setup. We use 25 kilometers of fiber, and we perform the real-time short noise measurement. But we are experiencing quite high excess noise, system excess noise. So this is the quantum channel, and this is the channel very adjacent to the quantum channel, and this is non-adjacent to the quantum channel. So while we use the channel adjacent to the quantum channel, you can see there is overlap in the transmission window, so you would see a leakage problem. So the result here shows that leakage problem. For example, here in the adjacent channel, as we increase the channel power, you can see that the noise is increasing, and it goes above the null key threshold. Okay, if the noise is above this particular value for 25 kilometers, you cannot make any key. So you have to keep the noise below your below the threshold key, null threshold excess noise. So in the forward direction, in the adjacent channel, we are seeing this due to the leakage. But apart from that, we are seeing we could make the positive key rate. We could have a positive key rate of around 3 kilobits per second. So this is a successful CVQKD DWDN deployment test for 25 kilometers because we are using a very intense 7 dBm classical channel, which is 5 milliwatt. Okay, so the analysis and the prospects of the our work is we are experiencing quite big, currently the noise is quite big, that limits our transmission distance to around 25 kilometer. But it's actually, we are not limited by the Raman noise from the channel, because actually we cannot see the Raman noise. To know more about this real-time measurement of our system, please have a look into the poster by Paul. It also explains the new closing the security loophole known as the calibration attack. Okay, so we are definitely we can improve our system stability. So we think by using gated homodyne, we can increase we can go to 0.2 at least, or maybe 0.1 also. So if you have the 0.2 short noise for the system noise, we can increase the distance from around 25 kilometers to around 50 kilometers for 0 dBm channel launch power. So as a conclusion, the strong noise filtering property of the homodyne detection is a real advantage of CV QKD in a DWDM network. So it's the first experiment of the coexistence of CV QKD in C-band with a very high classical channel power. And so at this rate, we have 3 kilobits per second, and it's limited by the system noise, not by the actual Raman induced noise. And we are expecting to increase the distance till 250 kilometers for 0 dBm. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We have time for a few questions.
It's a nice talk. I have two questions. The first question is, do you modulate your classical channel or do you use CW classical channels?
Pardon?
Do you modulate your classical channels or do you use CW?
It's average power. It's the power that I have shown here, but we don't modulate it. So for the moment, we don't have this facility to modulate. I mean, 1.2 gigabits per second, we don't have this facility
okay,
right
so
now.
So if you modulate your classical channel, would, here's a second question. If you modulate the classical channel, would other effects such as cost phase modulation be an issue?
Oh, you're saying if you modulate the channel, whether I could reduce the noise?
Would other effects such as cost phase modulation be an issue because you assume CW, right? So all calculations are based on CW, but once you modulate a signal, it's a different model, right? So,
would
the cost phase modulation be an issue here?
If you would have modulate the classical channel, uh-huh. Then there are other effects that are not included in the model.
No. It's not. We didn't include that model, any other model by modulator.
Do you know what will happen in that?
But we checked on it for crossfade modulation, and it shouldn't be an issue for practical parameters. It's much smaller than Raman.
There can be a crossfade modulation. Yeah. I didn't understand.
The worst one. The worst one.
Now, there are chances if you modulate and then modulate a classical channel, that modulation can cause a modulation on a crossfade modulation on the CV QKD signal. Then that can affect somehow our detection, but we are not actually sure about.
So another question, Thomas.
You showed a graph about the background noise versus distance, and there was a peak at about 20 kilometer, the previous slide.
This one?
Or this one too? Yeah. So is there a reason why it would? Reduce the Raman noise reduces again if you further?
In the forward direction, it's proportional to the power here. So once you send the light, for example, 1 milliwatt, the light, the intensity is decreasing. So that's, but in the reverse direction, the intensity is decreasing, but you are getting all the contribution from all the lines, so that it's saturating the backward direction. But in the forward direction, it peaks at 21.
Another question? So if this is not the case, let's thank Rupesh again.
Thank you.